All right, now can you hear? Can you hear on the WebEx? Can somebody? Yes, all right.
Thank you, Stacy Cesario.
Thank you.
Okay, so I was saying, if you're going to pay attention to anything from the guidelines between now and Saturday, this is probably the most important thing to pay attention to. And it sort of is the organization of how they want to group a bunch of incredibly disparate problems under one heading. So it looks at what you need to do when you first get a patient with some sort of underlying neurologic condition affecting their bladder into your clinic. And you need to think about what's the disease process, how is it affecting this patient in particular, and does that put them into either low risk or unknown risk category? And once I have them in either low or unknown, that's going to dictate the evaluation that I need to do initially, which is then going to stratify them into either moderate or high, which then is going to allow you to give you, is going to give you a roadmap for how you should follow those, follow these patients throughout the rest of your life as their urologist. So this is a very dense slide, but also a very high yield figure for you guys to look at. So we're going to talk a little bit about function and dysfunction. Really, really basic, right? The urinary tract involves the kidney, the ureters, the bladder, the urethra. The upper urinary tract is the faucet. That's how I like to talk to patients about it. And the lower urinary tract is your reservoir. It's your pitcher that's catching the fluid. But it's a dynamic reservoir, right? It can squeeze and it can stretch and relax. And it also involves the urethra, which is kind of like your spigot that you can turn on and off. And normal urination, right, doesn't, once, if it's working well for you, it's not something that you think about a lot. But it's an incredibly complicated sort of dynamic symphony of opposing neurologic impulses that involves the entire central nervous system. And so if anything disrupts that really delicate balance, urinary symptoms are manifest. So it's a combination of both voluntary, conscious, and involuntary or automatic muscle actions that coordinate to hold and then release urine, ideally when you want to, in a socially appropriate place. And I think this is always a nice slide to review. At the top is basically a urodynamic flow curve. Here is a pictogram of what the bladder itself is doing, sensations here, and then actually what the detrusor and the urethra are doing during filling and then emptying. So starting out in the filling phase, the detrusor muscle is relaxed and the urethra is contracted. Patient gets that first sensation to void, but is maybe not at a place where they think that they need to do that. So reflex mechanisms send information back to keep the detrusor in that relaxed phase and the urethra contracted. Maybe now it's really time to go. So you find a socially acceptable place for that to happen. A switch gets flipped and you go into the emptying phase from the storage phase. So the detrusor contracts and the urethra relaxes and then we go back to baseline. And then the flow curve obviously looks like that. A really basic, this should be the stuff you remember, that's gonna go away, about lower motor neuron innervation. So the parasympathetic acts by cholinergic receptors at M3 and is primarily the voiding reflex. Sympathetic acts via norepinephrine at the beta-3 agonist and the alpha-1 receptors, or beta-3 receptors and the alpha-1 receptors, primarily involved in storage. And then the pudendal nerve also by cholinergic receptors to affect the sphincter. The urine storage reflexes, again, are sympathetic. Remember, sympathetic and storage, and they act via the hypogastric nerve to keep the urethra contracted and the bladder relaxed. The micturition reflexes are parasympathetic, acting via primarily the pelvic nerve to contract the detrusor and inhibit the urethra. And the pontine micturition center, I think of as that switch that you flip to send a complicated series of information downstream to either keep everything in the storage phase or keep things in the urinary phase, emptying phase rather. And there's information from the frontal cortex that goes to the pontine micturition center to allow patients to, or to allow people to know when to do those things. Somehow I'm not, there we go. So in words, for filling and storage, it's a passive phenomenon that's dependent on the fact that the bladder is stretchy. And it's also dependent on the fact that there's no parasympathetic excitatory input during that storage phase. Storage is dependent on increased outlet resistance by means of the somatic striated sphincter guarding reflex. And the sympathetic reflex contributes by increasing outlet resistance via the smooth sphincter, by inhibiting the parasympathetic input, remember inhibiting the storage input, and then causing a decrease in bladder and smooth muscle tension. So continence, and then continence is maintained during increases in intra-abdominal pressure by the intrinsic competence of the bladder neck and the proximal and mid-urethra. When that's lost, that's where stress incontinence occurs. Storage is activated, is an activation of A-delta afferent nerve fibers, which stimulates sympathetic efferents via the hypogastric nerve, which causes relaxation of the detrusor and contraction of the bladder base. Somatic efferents via the patendal nerve increase striated external urethral sphincter tone. And there's parasympathetic inhibition. So it's inhibited, parasympathetic system is inactive due to the sympathetic inhibition. Voiding, once you're potty trained, is initiated by the cerebral cortex. And the first thing that happens is the sphincter relaxes. And voiding means that the sympathetic system is being inhibited and parasympathetic is allowed to do its job, which causes the bladder to contract and the urethra to relax. And so folks are at the highest risk for the most devastating effect of neurologic insult are folks who have issues below the pontine micturition center and above the sacral micturition center. Because when the flow from the pontine micturition center to the sacral micturition center is interrupted, that normal opposing relationship between the sphincter and the bladder is lost. And the degree to which that interruption it happens correlates with their risk for storage and emptying dysfunction, and then that correlates with the risk for upper tract deterioration, which is the main thing we have to worry about. So we'll keep going down here. Some of the causes of neurogenic bladder are NLUTD, and here they're separated into suprapontine, infrapontine, but suprasacral. Remember, that's the scariest, most worrisome collection here in the middle, and then infrasacral. So why are they scary? Because there's complications associated with that whole system not working the way it's supposed to. What are some of those long-term complications? The most important one that we have to worry about is upper urinary tract deterioration, which is a combination of vesicoureteral reflux, hydronephrosis, and then ultimately renal dysfunction. Incontinence certainly is a major issue, as are urinary tract infections, urinary stones in this population, and then malignancy can be an issue as well. So what can go wrong with the reservoir? It can either be underactive or overactive, or it can be a small capacity and not stretch the way it's supposed to. So small capacity bladder with decreased compliance or high pressure, low volume storage, those are all worrisome things. What can go wrong with the outlet? Well, it can be blocked by something like a big prostate or a urethral stricture. It can be not blocked, but still not working, which is what a functional obstruction is. So that's detrusor sphincter, can be detrusor sphincter dyssynergia. Or it can be hypotonic, so it's not serving its outlet closing function, and that's stress urinary incontinence. And again, just to, because I think this is so important to remember, and it just helps me frame how I think about this whole topic. So when the flow from the pontine micturition center to the sacral micturition center is interrupted, again, that normal opposing relationship between the parasympathetic and the sympathetic system is lost, and that's what leads to issues. So above the pontine micturition center, generally, these patients have storage problems. They're going to have urgency, urge incontinence. We'll go over this again. But they can empty well. So it stores, but it doesn't empty. Between here and the sacral cord, it doesn't store and it doesn't empty. That's the biggest issue. Below the sacral cord, it stores, but it doesn't empty very well. So just another way for you guys to potentially think about it. This is a urologic history pearl. This is Dr. Ed McGuire, who sadly passed away last year. Often considered one of the fathers of neurogenic bladder. He was at the University of Michigan for a majority of his career. And that's Ann Gormley, who's the chair at Dartmouth currently. Sorry. And they are the two folks who did most of the research that ultimately let us understand why patients, really this population that they looked at was with spina bifida, developed renal failure, and why the number one cause of death in that population for years was urologic. And that's altered compliance. So high pressure storage is a problem, and this is the reason it's a problem. So if you have, for instance, a spinal cord injury, you will get unopposed parasympathetic output. That's gonna lead to urine being stored at high pressure, which then leads to vesicoureteral reflux, The ureter can't deliver urine downstream, right? So you've got a kidney that can't drain. Same, it's the problem just like it is if there's a stone there. That's going to over time lead to hydronephrosis and post-renal obstruction, and then ultimately renal failure. So our job as urologists in patients with poor compliance is to try to interrupt this cycle as best we can to keep it from getting to the point of renal failure. Poor compliance can be an issue that is completely silent. And for that reason, that's why I have an entire guidelines that talks about surveillance for these patients, because patients may not have a symptom of this at all. There are a lot of different ways to classify neurogenic bladder or neurogenic lower urinary tract dysfunction. It can be neuroanatomic. We've gone through that just a little bit. Lapides classification, which I think is mostly for historical interest. Functional, which really helps you figure out what you can do to help the problem. And then urodynamic classification, which is probably also not incredibly useful. So the neuroanatomical classification is based on the portion and severity of the nervous system that's affected. So there can be suprapontine lesions, suprasacral spinal cord lesions, spinal cord lesions, or sacral spinal cord lesions, and then cauda equina and distal to that. And some of the suprapontine lesions are going to be a stroke, Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's, dementia, total brain injury, for instance. And it's going to be an issue between the cortex and the pontine micturition center. And as I mentioned, is going to involve detrusor overactivity, but generally with coordinated sphincter function. So they don't store very well, urine leaks out, they're wet, but they generally empty to completion. And of course, there's an enormous amount of fluidity between all of these categories, but for a starting point of thinking about it. Suprasacral lesions are going to be multiple sclerosis potentially, depending on where their plaques are, spinal cord injury, myelomeningocele, or spina bifida, and transverse myelitis. And suprasacral lesions occur between the pontine micturition center and S2 on the spinal cord. Remember that above T6, patients may have autonomic dysreflexia. And those patients tend to have detrusor overactivity, a bladder that doesn't store well, and then dysinergia, a bladder that doesn't empty well. Below S2 and peripheral lesions like tethered cord, diabetes, pelvic surgery like abdominoperineal resection, and low myelomeningocele lead to generally a bladder that doesn't squeeze appropriately. So it stores okay, but doesn't empty well because the smooth sphincter is fixed. This was a sneaky question on the in-service that I thought I would go over. So 1 month after an L5 laminectomy, a 30-year-old woman develops lower extremity weakness, a postvoid residual of 300, and an intermittent urinary stream. Urodynamics demonstrate DSD. The most likely explanation is, Jeremy? Can you tell me why? Yeah, so D is absolutely correct. And the thing to focus on, you're exactly right, is the detrusor sphincter dysinergia. Detrusor sphincter dysinergia happens on a spinal cord injury right below the pontine micturition center and above the sacral cord. And remember that there is a difference between the vertebral level and the spinal cord lower down. And so that's an important thing to remember. So for DSD, the injury or insult should be above the L2 vertebral level, which is actually where the sacral spinal cord exits. So that basically rules out everything in that list, except for pseudodysinergia and an undiagnosed MS. And the woman's young, as you said, so MS is a reasonable diagnosis. So just a highlight of that. So here's L2, and then here's the sacral cords going out. The Lapides classification, again, historical interest only. The functional classification, you can think about a bladder as failure to store and failure to empty, is a nice way of thinking about it in terms of thinking about treatment options. And so let's go to assessment and risk factors. So I think another important thing for everyone to keep in mind when they're seeing these patients are, what are your goals as the urologist? Well, a very important thing in this field, as well as in all fields of urology, is patient-centered outcomes and patient-centered goals. So certainly what you want to do is manage in line with the patient's goals and ability. You want to make sure that you are doing everything you can to preserve upper tract integrity and prevent renal failure. Continence generally falls in line with patient goals, so that's an important thing too. You want to do everything you can to minimize complications like infection and stones, and all of those things should help you improve quality of life and prolong life expectancy for folks with this problem. The initial evaluation should include a lot of things. So very specifically, you need to know what's the neurologic insult, how long has it been going on, what's the prognosis? Is this relapsing remitting MS or is this secondary progressive MS? Is this, you know, a muscular dystrophy that responds to the new medications where the life expectancy is, you know, forever now or not? Because that's going to affect how you treat things in some of those patient-centered outcomes and goals. You want to find out about how they're managing their bladder and the history of that. Really a good and thorough urologic history. And socioeconomic and social history as well, because you need to know what resources these patients have, how much help they have, because all of that's going to affect the things that you can offer them down the line. The physical exam should include some evaluation of mental status and cognition. It should include a urinalysis, and it should pretty much include a post-void residual in everybody who voids spontaneously. Other things that it can include are avoiding diarrhea, a pad test, and a non-invasive uroflow. And some other tools that you have in your toolbox, in addition to the post-void residual, could be upper tract evaluation or imaging, blood work or evaluation of the renal function, and then urodynamics. And really the definition, if you figure out that someone is low risk, then urodynamics may not be required. If they're in the unknown risk category, that's where you're going to start making sure you get some upper tract evaluation, blood work to evaluate serum creatinine, and urodynamic testing. And the results of those studies allow you to stratify patients into moderate or high risk. So imaging, urodynamic testing, renal function are the discriminating factors for risk stratification amongst those two categories. Just a little bit about urodynamics. Why do we do urodynamics? It's always important when you're ordering a urodynamic study, think about the question that you're trying to answer with it. What you hope to get from this is something that provides documentation of the neurologic disease on the lower urinary tract. Ideally, it should correlate the symptoms with the urodynamic events. So urodynamics ideally recreates what's happening in real life. And it should assess for the presence of urologic risk factors that are associated with those complications we talked about, DSD, poor compliance, sustained high pressure detrusor contractions, and vesicoureteral reflux. Okay. Why? Bladder behavior can't accurately be predicted by the level of injury. So those categorizations are good, but they're not perfect, and there is fluidity between the different categories. So they talk about the bladder as being an unreliable witness. Again, as we talked about before, diminished compliance can be completely asymptomatic until you start to see hydronephrosis or evidence of renal dysfunction. And urodynamics can help identify patients with increased storage pressures or increased outlet resistance who might require more earlier intervention. I think everybody knows what urodynamics is at this point. But from the filling phase, the things that we want to figure out is compliance, right? So the change in volume over changes in pressure. It also evaluates for involuntary detrusor contractions, which you might see in someone with a suprapontine issue. And then Rachel, storage pressures of greater than what result in upper urinary tract deterioration?
40.
Lovely, perfect. So 40 probably is a very reasonable thing to think about. For some patients, it's gonna be a little bit lower than that. For some patients, it'll be a little bit higher than that. And it's important to remember these are storage pressures, not voiding pressures, right? So that's when the bladder is gonna be exposed to these pressures for the longest period of time. On the voiding phase, you can assess detrusor function. So is the bladder squeezing? Is it hypotonic? Is it atonic? And you can assess for detrusor sphincter dysinertia. That's what the red arrows here are showing, a patient who, during maximum squeeze, there's also maximum exertion of the striated sphincter. Video urodynamics just means we add fluoroscopy, right? So we're putting in some dye that we can take x-rays of, allows us to assess for reflux at the same time, allows us to assess for abnormal bladder morphology, including bladder diverticulum, and can allow us to assess for DSD if we can take live fluoro pictures during attempts to void. So in this picture here, you can start to see reflux, which proves to be high grade when you take your fluoro machine a little higher up. So the questions that we hope urodynamics will answer are questions about bladder behavior, urethral behavior, and micturition. So is the bladder overactive, underactive, not active at all? What's the compliance? At what volume is the first desired avoid? What's the systemetric capacity? What's the post-void residual? Is it a high-pressure system or a low-pressure system, which is the compliance part? The urethral behavior, is it hypertonic, hypotonic, or unstable? And then the micturition, is it synergistic or dyssynergic? And then urodynamic classifications. So just a brief two slides on autonomic dysreflexia, which is one of those high-yield things. Who gets this? Patients with a spinal cord injury above T6, but you can see it in patients with a spinal cord injury at T7 or T8. Why? Because of noxious stimulus below the injury, which sends afferent stimulus upstream. And what are the symptoms going to be? Jeremiah. Okay, so it is hypertensive, and it can be a hypertensive crisis. It's actually bradycardia. So these folks will brady down into the 40s. Generally, their symptom is going to be a really bad headache, sometimes flushing or sweating, and nasal congestion. And because this is very serious and in particular, and also potentially life-threatening, patients who are at risk for autonomic dysreflexia, if you are doing a systo on them in the clinic, if you are changing a catheter, if you're doing urodynamics, need to have continuous hemodynamic monitoring during testing. And our nurses are great about providing that. If they have any of these signs or symptoms of having an episode, what's the first thing you do? Well, get rid of that noxious stimulus. And for us, primarily, that's going to be making sure the bladder is drained. You're going to want to put the patient, if they are supine, upright, because that provides you some orthostatic decrease in the blood pressure. And if no improvement with that, then treating with medications. Nitroglycerin paste or nitro paste is the primary, is the number one thing that you're going to want to use. You want to apply it above the level of the lesion. It works quickly, and it can be removed if they start to bottom out on their pressure. Sublingual nifedipine, which I do not believe we stock in clinic, is also something that can be used, but is a little more dangerous in terms of the potential hemodynamic effects when they're out of this initial crisis. But sometimes these are folks who have to go to the ICU for monitoring because this is dangerous. So again, everything you've done so far has talked about risk stratification, and these are the risks. So a low-risk patient is going to have normal renal function, low PVR, normal imaging, and pretty normal voiding, synergistic voiding on urodynamics. The moderate-risk patient may have normal stable renal function, could have an elevated residual, because that's a sign that there's something not working exactly the way it's supposed to, might have normal imaging, could have neurogenic retention or detrusor overactivity with incomplete emptying. And the high-risk patient is someone who has abnormal renal function, any changes on upper tract imaging, such as hydronephrosis or renal scarring, large staghorn stones, and then urodynamics that show poor compliance or reflux or high-pressure storage. And then that leads you to how you should surveil these patients. So low-risk patients probably don't need to see you every year. Moderate and high-risk do. They need annual assessment of their renal function. Imaging can vary depending on moderate or high. And urodynamics, for the most part, are done at baseline. And if there's any change in signs or symptoms, if any of the things like your renal function or your upper tract imaging suggest there's a new complication, if there's changes in imaging, like I said, or changes in renal function. So urodynamics ordered for cause, basically, thereafter is the recommendation. If you're going to remember anything, remember what you do for the high-risk patient. So initially, they need a BNP, urodynamics, and an ultrasound. Yearly, BNP, ultrasound, plus or minus urodynamic based on those three things listed there. And then follow up urodynamics ordered for cause to answer a very specific clinical question rather than for screening. And this is for adult patients. This doesn't necessarily apply to the spina bifida population, so don't take that downstream. Bringing you all back to what are your treatment goals in terms of management? Preservation of the upper tracts with that detrusor leak point pressure less than 40, prevention of infection, provide reasonable storage, provide reasonable emptying. Hopefully you can help them with continence to the best of your ability. So how can we manage the altered reservoir function? If it's underactive or non-contractile, it's really getting it empty with a tube. So intermittent catheterization or an indwelling catheter, or for some folks, sacral neuromodulation or electrical stimulation. For the overactive bladder, we have a few more tricks up our sleeve. So all of the pharmacologic agents that are listed there, Botox, electrical stimulation potentially, and bladder augmentation. And then for that small capacity bladder with decreased compliance, you're really looking at either augmentation or diversion. For the altered outlet with anatomic obstruction, right, it could be a stricture, you treat the stricture. If it's BPH, treat the BPH. If it's a functional obstruction, these are things you can try. In women, potentially alpha blockers, maybe beta 3 agonists, Botox into the sphincter, just simple Cardet maneuvers. Some studies talk about electrical stimulation of the transdermal electrical stimulation of the bladder can stimulate voiding. For men, potentially a TUIP or a sphincterotomy. And for the hypotonic outlet, all of the things that we do for stress urinary incontinence. Just a bit on anticholinergics, because again, in service, these are all the anticholinergics that are out there. On the left is the generic name, on the right is the brand name. How do they work? The detrusor muscle is really rich in cholinergic and muscarinic receptors. These medications block those receptors, which stabilize bladder muscle. There's probably some suburothelial effect as well, which mediates some of the urgency. And there's multiple muscarinic subtypes. Somebody, which are the ones that are most common in the bladder? Marissa. M2 and M3. So, ding. So this is my little animation. So the medications that we use are going to block M2 and M3 receptor presence in the detrusor muscle. M2 receptors make up about 2/3 of the muscarinic receptors in the detrusor, but M3 receptors seem to facilitate the normal contractile response in normal bladders. So the newer, which are not new anymore, anticholinergics are M2 and M3 specific. That also means there's less M1 effect, which is primarily the CNS effect. I'm not going into it a ton here, but there is concern that these medications not only can cause confusion when taken, but can lead to dementia if taken over the long term. So then the beta-3 receptors, or mirabegron, those work differently. They agonize, right? They're beta-3 agonists, so they potentiate the storage capability of the bladder rather than antagonizing the contractility of the bladder. And this is dense, but I think worth paying attention to. So the mode of action of OAB treatment over here on the right, if you block the muscarinic receptors, you're going to inhibit involuntary contractions. If you activate the beta-3 agonist receptors, you're going to increase relaxation. Theoretically, these should be better if taken together, and there's some studies to suggest that, some studies that don't. We're going to skip that. Oh, and just let you know that there is a new beta-3 agonist on the market called Vibegron or Gemtesa, not widely prescribable, at least in Wisconsin at this point. The benefits of it theoretically is that it's single dose, so you're not titrating up, no prolongation of the QT interval, and theoretically less effect on systolic blood pressure. Other things we can do, Botox. So Botox decreases the muscle's ability to contract by inhibiting acetylcholine release at the presynaptic cholinergic junction. Anybody remember that the two words you sort of have to remember about that pathway? Nice. And snare and snap, right? Snare and snap. So Botox can be done in the office, and truly Botox has revolutionized our treatment of neurogenic bladder for patients. We first started using it in the early 2000s. It was FDA approved for neurogenic bladder, I think in 2010 or 2012. And it really, again, has kept many patients from moving on to more aggressive therapy. So Botox gets encapsulated here. The Botox is cleaved into heavy and light chains. That light chain cleaves the snare protein. The snare complex doesn't form, and then acetylcholine can't be released. So that's always testable. 200 units for neurogenic bladder is the FDA approved starting dose. We certainly go up to 300 units, particularly in patients who are catheterizing. We're going to skip the studies. It's effective. So the take-home message here is that it decreases the episodes of incontinence by about 20 episodes per week and increases capacity by about 150 milliliters on average. We can also use Botox for detrusor for DESD. It involves injecting directly into the detrusor muscle. Botox in detrusor muscle versus smooth muscle is degraded much more quickly. So it does have to be repeated more often, and it's not enormously comfortable. So I haven't, I don't do a ton of this. I don't know if Dr. Grimes does. Into the sphincter. Yeah, it's, I think it's better than nothing, and but still not great. That's what I think about D's. Yeah. You can do it at the same time as bladder injections. Some of the surgical options, we're going to do a case here. So you have a 54-year-old woman with a T10 injury and poor hand function. She's had an indwelling catheter for 3 years. She leaks around the catheter. Hasn't gotten better with anticholinergic medication. And recently, the nursing home's calling you because the catheter is just falling out with the balloon blown up. These are her urodynamics prior to catheter placement. So 3 years ago, this was her urodynamics study. Who's back there? Emmy. What's an important thing to know about this study? She has a poorly compliant bladder. Exactly. So we're seeing this PDET trend up, and the end filling pressure is 20, 40, between 40 and 60. So that's concerning for upper tract deterioration. On the physical exam, she's a frail woman. She's on a stretcher today. She's got, depends on, her abdominal exam is benign. She doesn't have any pelvic organ prolapse. This is what her vaginal exam looks like. I mean, what are we looking at? We are looking at her bladder. That's exactly right. So this is the bladder neck here, and this is a completely obliterated urethra, which is what can happen with a long-term indwelling catheter in a woman, particularly an insensate woman, and actually in a fairly short period of time. So taken all together, what are the things we have to consider in terms of trying to help this patient? Her habitus, that's going to make a difference. Her dexterity, her overall level of function, the size of the urethral defect, does she have any urethra left? Where is it in relationship to the urethral orifices? The quality of her vaginal tissue, is it terrible as well? And then her bladder function from the urodynamics beforehand. And taking all together, Emmy, since you're doing awesome, what would you suggest for this patient? So it's going to be really hard to do urodynamics now because her outlet's completely open. So everything that goes in is going to flush out. So you hopefully you have some urodynamics from before they put the catheter in, which is what we have here, which shows not a great bladder, right? Not a bladder that stores particularly well. So I think we have a bad bladder and an obliterated outlet, as you identified. So I think in this patient, really probably urinary diversion because of the significant urethral destruction, poor tissue quality, the patient has limited function in terms of ability to catheterize themselves, and then the low capacity high pressure storage. But that isn't the only option, and the guidelines suggest that that should be the last option, so we'll go over some of the others. An ileovesicostomy involves basically taking a chunk of bowel, putting it on using it to augment a bit, or it can be used to augment a bit, but basically creating a chimney for emptying to the abdominal wall. So it's an incontinent diversion. It requires a compliant bladder, and it requires a competent outlet to be useful. It does preserve the anti-reflux mechanism of the ureters. You're not operating on the ureters. It's a reasonable option for a patient with limited dexterity who can't catheterize themselves. And it may require a concomitant outlet procedure if, in fact, they don't have a competent outlet. It's a tubeless diversion. The guidelines like to point out that this has a very high risk of needing subsequent procedures, which it does. A continent catheterizable stoma can be a Mitrofanov or a Monty. Mitrofanov tends to refer to a diversion made out of the appendix, Monty made out of bowel. It does require the patient's ability to be able to catheterize. It's often combined with an augment to create a large capacity, low pressure reservoir. It can require a concomitant outlet procedure, and it's generally an easier way for women with limited mobility to catheterize rather than per urethra. Augmentation or enterocystoplasty, treats the low capacity bladder by interrupting, how does it create a low pressure system? It interrupts the coordinated contraction of the detrusor so the bladder can't squeeze as effectively, and then it also obviously adds volume by making it a bigger reservoir. Great results with augmentation cystoplasty if you're looking at patient outcomes. There are long-term favorable urodynamic changes for these patients, but present and future dexterity is an issue if at first anybody who catheterizes via any way. This study I thought was interesting. It looked at Botox versus enterocystoplasty impact of quality of life. And really, ultimately, at least in this study, which wasn't huge, but enterocystoplasty wins. They tend to be drier. It's a bigger thing to go through, but ultimately less bother. And then finally, diversion, which you guys know about. So this is my last little bit. Like, I'm going to be on time. Specific conditions, a few specific conditions to talk about. Spinal shock. So in patients with spinal cord injury, spinal shock is something that occurs anywhere from days to months of decreased excitability of the spinal cord segments at and below the level of the lesion of the injury, which results in absence of somatic reflex activity and flaccid muscle paralysis below the level of the injury. During that time, the bladder tends to be acontractile. So most patients will have an Angelenne catheter initially, and then in rehab are taught to catheterize pretty early. The bladder neck is generally closed and the sphincter mechanism functional. And so it's important to postpone urodynamics until after the spinal shock phase is over, because you're going to have to do them again anyway when the spinal shock phase is over. So generally for about 6 months. So the first urodynamics roughly at about 6 months. A little bit about Parkinson's disease. Parkinson's disease, remember, is a suprapontine lesion. Involves degeneration of the dopaminergic neurons in the substantia nigra, but then also probably derangements of multiple pathways, not just that, because there aren't just motor symptoms. The non-motor symptoms are neuropsychiatric. So remember, Lewy body dementia is an aspect of Parkinson's disease. There are sleep disorders, there are sensory symptoms, and very specifically, there are autonomic disorders and bladder dysfunction in this population. And in general, the symptoms are urinary urgency, frequency, and urge incontinence, what you would expect with a suprapontine lesion. There was a very impactful and now largely disproven paper from, I think, 1988 by Dave Staskin that looked at treating patients with Parkinson's disease with a TURP. And they were not, patients who had both BPH and Parkinson's disease with a TURP to see if their outlet, if their incontinence and symptoms got better. And it showed that it didn't. And the theory at that time was because of bradykinesia of the sphincter. So the sphincter not relaxing the way it needed to. And even though you've eliminated the prostate outlet obstruction, there was still outlet obstruction for that. It has since been shown that that's probably actually not something that occurs. There were actually a lot of patients in that study that probably had multiple system atrophy. And multiple system atrophy, which is a variant of Parkinson's disease, that is really exemplified by earlier and more severe bladder symptoms, particularly higher PVRs and increasing PVRs in a fairly rapid period of time. And in fact, an elevated PVR on earlier dynamics in patients with Parkinson's could actually help discriminate between multiple system atrophy and Parkinson's disease. And so a TURP or a HOLEP is unlikely to improve symptoms in this population, but it actually can improve symptoms in patients with Parkinson's disease alone. So you might still see on some old SASPs questions about this, about not doing a TURP on a patient with Parkinson's, which is not true anymore or has been disproven. In terms of multiple sclerosis, you know, risk stratification really is dependent on the plaque location. So a spinal cord plaque really puts them in that higher risk between the pontine micturition center and the sacral micturition center. And remember, because multiple sclerosis is something that changes into over time and new plaques develop, risk stratification is going to change over time. So these are generally patients who are going to be followed in urology for most of their lives, and usually at least moderate risk. Ooh, hold on. So for moderate risk, anybody who wants to answer, do they get surveyed? Yes. H&P, you should see them how often based on our guidelines. Arigno. Yearly. Renal function, upper tract imaging, urodynamics, 4, changes in the other stuff, good job. So upper tract imaging, if in moderate risk, can be every 1 to 2 years. In a patient in MS, it's actually been shown that folks who don't have much lower motor effect or their legs aren't affected don't tend to have upper tract changes over time. And so while I used to do yearly renal ultrasounds, I don't always in that population anymore. This is a nice, I thought a nice pictogram from Claire Fowler, one of the grandmothers of neurogenic bladder, looking at the options for a patient with MS, particularly if they have progressive MS at different levels of function, because function really does dictate what you can offer patients. It also dictates often how the bladder is performing. So take home messages, remember that your goals of care are to preserve the upper tract, try to keep them continent, try to minimize complications, which should hopefully align with their goals of care of improved quality of life and prolonged life expectancy. The high-risk people that you have to worry about and need to be the most vigilant about paying attention to are those folks who have lesions along the spinal cord. Those tend to be demyelination injuries, MS, transverse myelitis, trauma or spinal cord injury, infarct, AVM malformation in that area. It could be neoplasm or metastasis, hereditary spastic paraparesis, and patients with spina bifida. Poor compliance leads to renal failure. Just remember how that works. And then if you remember anything about surveillance, remember this one. This is how you should be taking care of these patients. This is for Dr. Knadler. Any questions? You can steal any time from Journal Club. Yes.
So for the
yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if we truly had no idea of how her bladder functioned ahead of time, we didn't have any aerodynamics that showed, so she had pretty high pressure storage. So if we close her outlet, even with an SP tube, potentially she's going to develop upper tract deterioration over time. You could do an SP tube and Botox and a bladder neck closure. Bladder neck closures have a success rate of roughly 40% of staying closed in the best of hands. And particularly, so if you are going to have this high pressure system pressing against your fresh closure at the bottom of the bladder, I think it's I might think about that in someone with a normal bladder, you know, who could catheterize in someone with a normal bladder where an SP tube would function, but with bad bladder dynamics to start with, I think you might be setting yourself up for failure. Dr. Richards. Thank you. I think we wait too long. I think patients, though, drive that a lot of time as well. So I'm going to come in for my Botox every 6 months is a lot more palatable than, you know, than potentially an augment and continent catheterizable stoma, particularly for maybe a young woman who still wants to have kids, or they have a bunch of other health issues that they have to attend to, which most of these people do, that might be a higher priority for that. So I think some of it's doctor driven, but I think a lot of it's patient driven. I think Dr. Grimes was just talking to me yesterday about a patient who he has been urging towards augmentation for a few years, and patients were like, oh no, I don't really desperately want to do that if I don't have to. And that was one of the reasons I brought up the study that I did, which show if you retrospectively looks at ultimately what's your quality of life after an augment versus kind of limping along with Botox. Probably better after an augment or diversion or something other than Botox. All right, thank you so much, guys. Good luck on Saturday.